Hello, and welcome to this, a companion to A.K. Warder's Grammar Guide, an introduction to Pali. Today, we look at Lesson 9, which covers the passive conjugation and the feminine noun gender. This is Pali Studies on the Learn Pali channel. So, I know what you're thinking. Didn't we cover the passive voice back in Lesson 7? When we looked at the past participle? Well, the answer is yes. If you remember, the active voice is when the noun in the nominative case, that is the grammatical subject, is the agent doing the action of the verb, while the passive voice is when the action happens to the subject, that is, the noun which appears in nominative undergoes the action of the verb, and any agent will be in the instrumental case. Now, the past participle in Pali is by far the most frequent form of passive construction. But Pali has a second, less common way to indicate the passive voice. And this is with a specific passive verb derivation, which Warder here calls the passive conjugation. So let's look at how it's formed and how it's used. The passive verb, also sometimes called the passive stem, is created with the derivational infix ya, and this can be added to any normal verb as long as it's transitive, that is, able to take an object. So ya is added to present stems by means of a joining I sound, which can either be long or short, and this replaces the final vowel of the stem. And note with the seventh class of verb, those ending in ir and ea, the ea variant is also dropped. And when attached to the verbal root, if it ends in a long vowel, ya can be added directly. Short vowels may be lengthened, but it's quite common to drop the vowel altogether and use a joining I sound, which can be either long or short. When the root ends in a consonant, if it's a h or a r, ya can be joined by connecting I, but these also commonly metathesize, which means simply that certain sounds swap around. And this, in fact, is a remnant of different spoken dialects within Pali. But for other consonants, the y sound assimilates. And you may remember, in the last lesson when we talked about the absolutive suffix ya, I mentioned that it assimilates. So let's look now at the assimilation of the y sound a little deeper. Okay. When two dissimilar consonants meet, the result is often a single longer sound. And with Pali being a phonetic language, meaning that it's spelt how it sounds, that contraction of adjoining sounds is reflected in the spelling. And this effect is called assimilation. Now, when the second consonant is a y sound, the result is often a duplication of the first consonant. There are exceptions. T y becomes ch, and d y may become j, or just d. So if we now look at some examples. From the root lub, meaning to get, we get labha, which means got or is taken. From the root han, meaning to strike, we get hanya, which is struck or killed. And vach, to speak, becomes vucha, is said or spoken. And finally, from the root vid, to find, we get vidya, which is found. So keep a lookout for those double consonants, as the passive stem can be hard to recognise because of this assimilation. And by now you know that these are just bases, which then have to be inflected to agree with their subject. So to create the present passive, we simply add the present tense personal endings. This is called misery. And being passive, any agent is placed in the instrumental case. The Dharma is taught to the lay people by the Blessed One. But it's actually quite common for no agent to be expressed and so create an indefinite or impersonal sense. As in, through dispassion, he is freed. Note that English does not have a passive verb inflection. Instead, the passive voice is always created by a combination of an auxiliary verb with a past participle. And it's the auxiliary verb which indicates the tense. And so here we're using the present tense of to be, is freed. And another important point is to recognize that the passive infix ya is actually a derivational affix that alters the verb to create a separate passive stem, which, theoretically at least, can be inflected into any verb tense or mood. So as a result, the passive stem is sometimes called a secondary conjugation or a secondary derivation, which I must say I always find a little counterintuitive. To be honest, these inflections are rare on the passive stem, but the most frequent are the passive indicative that we've just seen, the aorist, and the present participle. So let's now look at these. To the passive stem, we can add the aorist endings that we saw way back in lesson 4, and this creates the simple past tense of the passive, which is almost always just found in the third person. From pollutions, the mind was freed. Here the ahi ending looks like an instrumental, but it's actually an ablative, which gives a sense of separation. In English, we'd normally render this with the preposition from. And finally, we saw last week that one suffix used to create the present participle was that of mana, applied to the present stem. Well, this ending is actually far more commonly applied to passive stems, which results in a passive present participle. Now, English doesn't have a passive present participle, but we can approximate the meaning by using a present progressive auxiliary verb, which gives us being done or while being done. And being participles, these decline to agree with the subject in number, case, and gender. Vimuchamano is being freed. And ugaching is the first person aorist. Being freed, I arose. In this next example, kata is an adverb meaning where. And we have a passive present participle which agrees with the subject tanha in gender, case, and number, and there's also a passive verb in the present tense which agrees with the subject in person and number. And so we get the question, where, while being abandoned, is thirst abandoned? And note, in English, to maintain that passive sense, we have to use a past participle. But many translators actually switch to using just present participles. And here, tanha, thirst, is actually a feminine noun. And so this nicely brings us to the last noun gender, the feminine. And Warder gives us the declensional endings for feminine noun stems that end in a long A, which is actually the vast majority. So if we look at these now, and compare them to the masculine and neuter endings, we can see that long A ending remains unchanged in the nominative singular, and also sometimes in the plural. The accusative singular has the familiar ang ending, whilst the vocative takes a unusually. And in the instrumental, which is the other noun case we've seen, we have ea in the singular, but we can see that characteristic he ending in the plural. So Warder now lists some feminine nouns and a bit more vocabulary to learn. And finally, exercise 9. Well, next week we'll see the future verb inflection and the genitive noun case. And until then, feel free to check out my other tutorials.